much enjoyed my time presiding over the Senate as Lieutenant Governor. That's the main job of the Lieutenant Governor these days. And I can tell you this, that the 46 men and women there, I felt like I was getting a PhD just about every day in some different subject. Because I learned something when I went up, that people say, well, all you have to do is preside, just call on people, call on Senator Alexander, call on these different, that's all you have to do. But also, you have to vote. The Lieutenant Governor in this state votes in case of a tie. Well, what does that mean? That means that you have to know the details and the issues on every single thing that comes before the Senate, because you might have to vote on it. And that's how I got a PhD, listening to the senators talk and explain those bills. It really was a great experience. And I promise you this, you cannot do better in this state than you do with Senator Thomas Alexander. I promise you that, because I've worked with him a long time. I've known him longer than that. And as you mentioned, my daddy, who passed away 2 years ago, used to speak of him as well. And if anybody my dad thought highly of, he was high on my list. By the way, he passed away, he's almost 101. He's just 3 weeks short of 101. He tried his last case, jury trial at 93, and won, 93 years old, that is, and left the law office at 99, finally went to the house. So, y'all, I got some time. I'll get some things done. But a little quick story you might have heard on the way to Republican. I'm a Republican, so I went to the Republican convention in Cleveland. And on the way up, I was asking Peggy, if you ever in your wildest dream seen your husband Henry nominating Donald Trump for president at the Republican National Convention in your wildest dream. She says, I hate to tell you this, but I've never seen you in any of my wildest dreams. He's in Spartanburg, I picked out myself. But this is a great state. That's what I'm here to tell you. And our job is to not mess it up and to see that we do not lose the opportunity to grab what will be the greatest economic prosperity and growth that our state's ever had. And I've tried to study history as much as I can. I've read a lot of books, listened to a lot of people, read a lot of articles, and looked around as much as I can to try to figure out how it is that we got to where we are. And I don't know the answer. I'm a student. I'm not a historian. But I know this, that over the years, South Carolina, which began in 1670, and we've been through everything that there is, every kind of war. We started off, we've been fighting ever since the beginning, in the French and Indian War, just to make a living, just to survive in the colony, before it was even a colony, just to settle. We had people coming back in the late 1500s and then the 1600s. We've been through everything, hurricanes, floods, Revolutionary War, more battles fought in South Carolina, battles and skirmishes in South Carolina, over 200 than any other colony among all the colonies. Now, our National Guard is number one in readiness. That means ready to fight. They have been for year after year after year after year. In fact, I was talking to a very high general recently in the Army who said that if he had to, it would be very easy to populate the entire army from South Carolina in just four of the states that were southern states, by the way. And he said he could do that. He said South Carolina has a military history, which is a history of strength and determination. And then you overlay that without being, as some say, the buckle of the Bible belt, and you end up, when you analyze it, people from these different countries, from England and Scotland, and the Huguenots from France, and the slaves that were brought over from Africa, and you put all these people and go through all of these things, you end up with what we have here today, as well as new people coming in, because it's getting better and better. You don't find anybody leaving South Carolina to go to Minnesota or any place like that. They all come in here. 47 new people a day come to Charleston to live to the metropolitan area of Charleston, just as but here we are. Every state has its own flavor. The mountains make a difference. The ocean makes a difference. The geography makes a difference. And then what we've built over the years makes a difference as well. But whatever it is that has influenced all of us, it is something that we don't notice as much as the people from other countries do. And I tell you, in this position, my position, I've had the opportunity to speak to a lot of those people and big companies that have come here, those that are interested in coming, those that have been here for a while. And they all say the same thing. We talk about the assets that South Carolina has. Great research universities, one of them is right here, Clemson, USC, the Medical University. They collaborate not only with each other, but with businesses. We have businesses partnering with research universities. When people come to my office to examine the state and see what the state can offer, how we work, what we do, that's one thing that they are fascinated by, is the opportunity here to work with a research university. Imagine you've got a company, you're trying to be innovative, you need research, and then you got a research university right there. We got people that would just love to come over and work in your business, in your plant, to figure out how to do things better and quicker. That's something we offer all the time. In fact, every time I meet with them, I tell them what I just told you. We have three major research universities, and they want to work with you. And you can see the lives just light up, and it happens when they get here with apprenticeship programs and other kinds of things. What else do they like? Well, they like the fact that our port is a major port, the Port of Charleston. It's a harbor, it's not a river. That's why the Port of Savannah will never be as big as ours, and others won't either. And we have a deep water port. We're 47 feet at low tide now. After the dredging, it'll be 52 feet at low tide and 55 feet at high tide. Well, at 52 feet at low tide, that means these big ships that are being built now that will go through the Panama Canal will be coming up the East Coast, not just going to the West Coast. Panama Canal can now accommodate those big ships, and they are big. You ought to see them. 13,000 TEUs, they call them. Those transportation units you see on the trucks going up and down. 14,000. Now, who would have imagined a few years ago that kind of traffic would be going? Well, we can bring them into Charleston now, but only at high tide. And put them in the berth. The berths are plenty deep to get in and out. It needs to go to at least 52 feet. And the ships don't draft that much, but you want to have a little bit of them. But anyway, we'll be right there. In not too many years, the Port of Charleston, the Port of New York, New Jersey will be the two dominant ports on the Atlantic coast. The way you spell port is M-O-E-Y. We have, what else do we have? Other states, some states don't even have an ocean, as you know, much less a port, much less a deep water port, much less a deep water port, 24 hours a day. You can get two ships going in and out at the same time, it's wide enough. And we have an inland port, which is the rail line, Norfolk Southern, running from Charleston up across 85 at Greer. And we're opening up another one running from Charleston up the CSX line through Dillon and across 95. That means a trucker can put his load in Greer, they can put it on the train, it'll go, and then he can go on about his business. He can pick up a load there at Greer that has been brought the night before on the train and carry it on south and north, east and west, without having to go to Charleston, drop the load, and come back. That's 400 miles that he doesn't have to drive. He or she doesn't have to drive. Same things will happen in Dillon. The people coming here, these businesses, they want to know about the port, because there are a lot of them in the heavy imports to get the materials they need and heavy export. We export more tires from South Carolina than any state in the country. We are in, how about this, BMW in Greer builds a new BMW rolling off the assembly line every 61.7 seconds. Every 61.7 seconds. And 70% of those are exported right now. We couldn't do without that port, without what we get from that port. But we have it, other states don't. Whatever. The best technical college system in the whole world. Everybody knows it. Started in 1961. Since then, it's matured, it's been accelerated. We now have apprenticeship programs. We now have the Ready SC program, started years ago. Most people don't know about this, and of course, these companies do. They find out about it. But what Ready SC is, it uses our technical college system. It has 16 established technical colleges around the state. You have one here, the Tri-County Technical College. It cooperates very closely with Clemson. It's a good relationship. Well, what do we do? if a company from Germany or Japan or any other company, name one, Sweden, if like Volvo, if they are interested in coming here, they show interest, we tell them that we have from our technical college system with something called Ready-SC, we can send a group to their country, to their plant, to analyze what they do, to understand the customs, the traditions, what's necessary to work those machines, the skills that are necessary to come back and create a curriculum that will teach students here, and we have a network of 16. You can get the word out pretty that this college or this college will be teaching courses that will lead to the kind of skills and understanding you need to work these machines. Some cost millions of dollars. And by the way, that they don't take two boxes in there anymore. Everybody carries laptops. It's a different world in these big plants now, which is something we need to adjust to, because those jobs pay real, real good money. They're highly sophisticated. It's different from the way it used to be. We have a cultural misunderstanding today of how good those jobs are, and how with a two-year technical college associate degree, you can get those jobs, and you can go back for certificates to move on up. You have no college debt, and you end up sometimes making two or three times as much money as your parents have been working their whole life. And they're a high quality, sophisticated job. Cultural obstacle for a lot of our young people. The parents don't want them, they want them to go and get a master's degree, a four-year degree, and that's good, because we need all of it. But everybody doesn't need to do that, particularly right after they get out of high school. We got 22-year-olds buying houses in South Carolina. We have people that go in and get their welder's degree and walk out the door and make $75,000. And to get a nuclear welder's degree, that's $100,000. And right now, we got a shortage of 60,000 people for jobs that are available like those I'm talking about. We're working on that. We've got a program where we want to get the word out. And that's one thing I'm telling you. But that's something else we have, that technical college capacity is getting stronger and stronger. Is a great asset. Our right to work law, we have the lowest union participation in the United States. We have a great attitude about business and industry that renders a union organization unnecessary, is the way most of our workers here see it. Boeing had an election not long ago, and the union was voted down by a very large market. So those are some of the things we have. Research universities, technical college support, we've got plenty of electric power. We're working on that, but as you know, we have a situation now involving Scanlon and Santee Cooper, and I was in Washington yesterday meeting with the Secretary of Energy, and felt like his entire executive staff there yesterday on very short notice, and we're working on that to be sure that we have plenty of electric power for what's coming down the road in South Carolina. But anyway, so as we explain all those advantages and we show these companies where we have land, where they have the counties, or some of them are looking for this kind of thing, others are looking for something else, they have very vigorous local organizations that are eager to get these businesses in. What is the thing that they say that is most important? After they digest all that and see what kind of incentives that we have, what sort of tax relief or anything, what's available, and we're very reasonable about that. What's the main thing they look for? It's the people. It is always the people, and what I was saying from the beginning. The chairman of BMW recently, after 25 years, they were expanding again in Greer. Volvo, by the way, down in Berkeley County, Volvo has not even finished their first building, and they already announced just a couple of days ago, they expanded already. I mean, that just does not happen very often. But the chairman of BMW said, and I quote, he said, South Carolina is a handshake state. If a man or woman gives you their word, they'll deliver, they'll keep it. He said, I've been all over the world looking for places to go, and BMW, this is their biggest production plant in the world. That I've been to many places across the world in the United States. There's not another place like South Carolina. And I agree with you. So we are really, my part of my message is that we have every asset that we need. We have the right people, we have the right places, we have the right institutions. There's been a lot of leadership exerted over the years in getting us to where we are. And so what I see our job now to do is to step on the gas and just keep on going and don't slow down. There's a saying in NASCAR, if you ain't first, you're last. Anybody here ever been to the Darlington 500 or the Southern 500? That's an amazing thing. And you talk about excellence. ICAR over there, that's the Center for Great Excellence. It's off the scale. And everything that they do there is understood by those young, courageous drivers. I was down there the last time. They had, I think, 40 young men and one young woman, and they were driving those cars. I mean, well over 100 miles an hour on the stretch, it's 180. But the interesting thing is the technology, the precision, they're this far, about a quarter of an inch off the ground, engineered down, the engineering, the electrical computer equipment, they can tell you the driver's heart rate, they can tell you his body temperature, the temperature of each tire, they can change those tires in about 10 seconds. And in 1986, speaking of excellence, and I believe that excellence in one thing like football or baseball or basketball, national championships of which we are all very familiar with, of course, excellence in one thing leads to excellence in another. In 1986, two cars, the average speed was 125 miles an hour. Average speed, that's with pit stops and yellow flags and all of that that slowed. 125 miles an hour, just over 400 miles. And the margin of victory was 2/1000ths of a second. That's a lot closer than 1-point ball game. That is excellence. So we are in the business of excellence. We've got excellent institutions. We've got nature has just blessed us. And what I see is, as I said, we got to accelerate because we have 50 states. They're all passing laws. They're building new programs. They're doing things to get ahead of each other. I was at the Southern Regional Energy Board in Charleston Monday. I think it was Monday. And everybody there recognized that South Carolina is right on the top. So why I'm here is to tell today is to tell you that and remind people like the city slicker who went to the circus and saw the big elephant, Jumbo, out there, huge elephant, had a little tiny chain around his leg, hooked up a little tiny stake, and the city slicker says to the ringmaster, that elephant doesn't walk away, why didn't he could pop that thing and just walk away and not know it, not even feel it. He said, well, we put that chain on him when he was a baby and tried as he might, he couldn't get loose. And so now he doesn't even try. Now he doesn't think he can do it. Somehow or another, that's infected us a little bit. It happens to all people. You lose confidence, you lose your vision. But ladies and gentlemen, there's no power in a small idea. If you're gonna go at all, go all the way. And Jim Clement said it, Harris Pastese said it, said, I'm tired of hearing people say that South Carolina is a small, poor state and we can't do anything. Well, I am too, and I know about it, because I'm seeing, and just as you are, what we are doing right now. And that is, the best indication is the people from all over the country that look at us and tell us what they see. Robert Burns said, the gifts the give ye give us to see ourselves as others see us. He said it in Gaelic or something. It's not quite like I just said it. You've got to say it like that, understand? So they see us in a way that we don't. So we're on the top of the world. But what we have to be alert to is we've got to keep on going. You can't ever stop. We have to keep inventing. We have to be innovative. We've got to collaborate. We've got to communicate. One reason the Hurricane Irma didn't hurt us any worse than it did was we probably had the best tuned, most practiced, most precision organized, best collaborative, best communicated bunch of professionals working that you ever saw anywhere. I mean, we had the word was situational awareness, and we could tell you among the group that we had all there in that one headquarters, we could tell you almost where the raindrops were coming down. It was wonderful. And because of that, even when faced with traffic coming out of Florida and Georgia that we've never had before in a hurricane, just flooding through here, it just went like clockwork. And that's because of that pursuit of excellence and going the next step before it becomes unnecessary. You don't want to react. You want to think ahead, have some vision. So what I see for us is even more excellence. even more power, economic power. Economic prosperity can solve more problems than every law we can possibly pass. Economic prosperity, people having good jobs, good paychecks, that are happy in the work that they're doing. Criminal domestic violence goes down. Child predators go down. Marriages go up. Divorces go down. Drug usage goes down. Criminal activity goes down. Everything gets better when you have economic prosperity. And we have to work on education. We have to work on law and order. There are many things that we have to do. But the one thing that's common to all is economic prosperity. So how do we maintain that and make it go even faster in just a few seconds? Because we have to keep taxes low. We have to eliminate regulations that stifle business, and there are plenty of them. I was just reading about the federal income tax on the way up. It reminded me how high those things are. You know, the top marginal rate is now 39.6%. Can you imagine how we? It used to be up around 90% way back. I think before President Kennedy lowered taxes, and when he lowered taxes, he was one of the first supply side. You know, said lower taxes. People have more money. They'll spend it. They'll invest it. And although people individually may pay less, because so many more people are working, you know, tax money coming into the government act is more. And Ronald Reagan did the same thing, great president. So we got to keep those taxes low. That's why I vetoed that gas tax. Largest tax increase in South Carolina history. Unnecessary gas tax, an unnecessary gas tax. We had $626 million coming in from the 12¾ cents. If we'd been spending all of that on the roads all along, we wouldn't have had to raise it a penny. We were throwing away about a third to 40% or 45%, according to some estimates, on things that ain't got a thing in the world to do with putting pavement down and building roads and building bridges. Nevertheless, the law is passed over my veto, and now I have the authority to see to it that the commission, the highway commission, runs well. And my vision and belief and message to the highway commissioners is, we want to stick with the priorities developed by the professionals at the highway department, with input from anybody who wants to give input. We will stick with those priorities, and if they're not willing to stick with those priorities, I have the authority to go ask them to do something else, which I'd be happy to do. But we have to be sure that we have a good, strong infrastructure. We have to be sure that we're educating the children. We've got to keep taxes low. When we were talking about raising our gas tax, North Carolina was talking about reducing theirs because they saw that as a great economic advantage. They wanted to reduce theirs. And remember this, ladies and gentlemen, a lot of us are happy and comfortable, but there are a lot of people who make a living with trucks. They do a lot of driving. They don't get 25,000 miles to the gallon. They don't get put 15,000 miles on their trucks. They put twice that much, and they get about 7 miles to the gallon. And for a lot of people, that gas tax is the thing that hurts them. And when the people that have these small businesses that are trying to come up are constantly reminded every time they go to the gas pump that I'm paying more money for whatever it is, it hurts those people. Fortunately, I don't drive a truck like that, but there are a lot of people that do. And if the people that are not at the top, people that are trying to get to the top, if they can make it, then everybody can make it. So we have to always keep that in mind. Keep the taxes low, keep the regulations down on small businesses, large businesses, every business, and we'll be in great shape. And always communicate, collaborate, talk to your colleagues, find symmetries, find different groups that our different businesses can work together, particularly when it comes to technical colleges and research universities. And I believe there's not another state in the country that can keep up with us. So that's my story. And as Alex Hawkins said, that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Y'all remember he played football at USC, he and King Dixon and others. Those were great years. I'd be happy to answer any questions. I'd love to hear anything about regulations. That you know, if you know one is strangling somebody, let us know. I don't know what everybody's business is, and so I wouldn't come in contact. Some things I would, others I wouldn't, but we need to hear from people. And so now or later, if you write it down, if you got an idea, send it to me. Politics essentially is a hunt for the next good idea. And I'm looking all the time. And I talk to my colleagues all over the country to see what they're doing and see where they have a good idea. Wonder if that'll work here. But we need that sort of intellectual stimulation and factual basis in order to make good decisions. Thank you. Any questions? Suggestions? Well, got to be at least one. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It's a great day in South Carolina.
Amen, bro.
I'm not about to wake up and be part of it. Governor, it's such a pleasure to have you here. I've been a follower over the years. I've admired all that you've said and done. I'm a construction planner, which means I'm too lazy to get out here and work on the paperwork I got. This is similar to your search for bad regulations. There are a lot of them. The process to get plans approved varies from one place to the next for the exact same thing. And it's getting too long to get the simplest project approved, whether it's stormwater or regular straight up building codes. I can't identify one regulation that needs to go away. I'm sure somebody here could. Nobody wants to whine about spotted owls. Nobody wants to put sewage in the drinking water. But getting permits approved so we can work is very frustrating. I just want you to be aware of that as you go around the state. You'll probably hear that from
We've heard that before.
And yes, sir. Thank you again for coming up and listening.
Oh, I'll be back. Thank you. Also, we hear a lot about getting permits and the time it takes, and also the multiple jurisdictions. If you want to build something here, you got to go to a whole bunch of different places. And we're analyzing that to try to come up with a better system. Y'all heard Donald Trump talk about it, just to mention somebody recently. It's a very high level. He said the cost of delay in getting permits and getting started is almost equal sometimes to the cost of the project itself. So if we can do it quickly, not make mistakes, if we can do it quickly, then it would save a lot of money and add certainty to business. And when you got certainty in business, then things go much better. But thank you. Agreed. Yes, sir.
Governor, I have one. I came down just to speak right quick, and I'm sorry I was late. But specifically, just one thing, and I know this is personal to me, probably nobody else in the room, but I'm not sure if anybody speaks. With the DOT department, a lot of people in this room probably do not realize this, but the DOT contractors are awarded their work by sealed bid, which is the way it ought to be. But the consultants and the designers who are hired by the DOT are negotiating. Huge problem there, in my opinion. Just a personal big thing.
You're right.
You said you're right. Actually, the solution to that is such a simple thing. I'd ask Senator Alexander to get up and explain that. Those are the kind of things that we're looking for. I'm glad you brought that up, because I don't know if we've heard that one, at least not lately. Thank you.
One more, I won't take up anybody's time. Okay. You want one more for the DOT and his personal opinion. The QCT quality team has been put in place over the last few years. Senator Alexander's familiar with, I'm sure, even as we talked about it. In my personal opinion, it's the worst thing the DOT's ever done to try to assure quality control. The engineers are now more focused on their paperwork to make a good grade on it than they are to actually build the road. Personal opinion.
I'll check that.
A lot of other contractors will agree with that, I believe, and we're going to save money.
Thank you very much. Any more questions, suggestions, ideas? Okay. Well, y'all, thank you for letting me join you today. This is a great-looking group up here. I love this part of the state. I don't get here nearly enough. There's a lot of places I don't get nearly enough. But I assure you, we're thinking about you all the time. This is a great, great state. I'm proud of it. I can't tell you how proud I am to be representing all of you. And I hope that as I work for you, I hope you'll be as proud of me as I am of you. And I appreciate you letting me be with you. Thank you.